In this lesson, we're going to discuss two organometallic reagents that are formed from alkyl halides. Let's look at the typical reactivity of an alkyl halide. Bromine is more electronegative than carbon, so we have a dipole here. When treated with a nucleophile in a substitution reaction, we'll get attack of the nucleophile at the delta positive carbon. Bromine leaves and we get this substitution product. So in this typical reaction, carbon is an electrophile. Now, starting with an alkyl halide like this bromide, we can generate new organometallic reagents. First, let's look at alkyllithium reagents. We have a generic halide here. Typically, X will be bromine or chlorine in this reaction. When this halide is treated with two equivalents of lithium metal, we get replacement of the halide with lithium, and we also form an equivalent of a lithium halide salt. Grignard reagents are generated similarly. The alkyl halide is this time treated with magnesium metal. And this forms the Grignard reagent, essentially where this magnesium metal is going to jump in between the carbon and the halide here, forming a new bond. Now, these alkyllithium and Grignard reagents, they do have covalent character in this carbon-metal bond. However, there's significant ionic character as well. So let's see what this reagent would look like if we thought about it as ions. Let's start with magnesium. This is in group 2 on the periodic table. It tends to lose 2 electrons to form a 2+ cation. Now the halide is going to be balancing that. See here, we have a Br-, so our halide is going to be anionic. We'll represent this as X minus over here. Now, we've only balanced one of the positive charges with a negative. So that means that the carbon atom bearing the metal actually has negative character. So in treating halides like this with a metal, lithium or magnesium, we've gone from carbon being an electrophile to carbon being a nucleophile. So instead of being attacked, carbon is going to be the thing that does the attacking. Let's look at the reactions of alkyllithium and Grignard reagents. They're very similar. The first reaction we'll look at is the addition to the carbonyl group of aldehydes and ketones. It's important that we're just considering aldehydes and ketones because some other carbonyl groups will behave differently. Let's start with acetone as our example. And we'll react this with the Grignard reagent, ethyl magnesium bromide. Oxygen is more electronegative than carbon, so we have a dipole in this molecule. So this anionic nucleophilic carbon atom is going to attack at the delta positive carbon atom of the carbonyl. We'll show the magnesium carbon bond doing the attacking. We can't make 5 bonds to carbon, so we'll push those electrons up onto oxygen, and we get this intermediate. This is an alkoxide. And typically we want the alcohol, so we're going to protonate this. We'll treat this, and it's very important, this is in a separate step. We'll add in some acid, which I'll represent as H+, and that's going to give us our alcohol. So here we've reacted a ketone and made a tertiary alcohol. Aldehydes react analogously, and let's look at the reaction of this aldehyde with an alkyllithium reagent. This is the reagent phenyllithium. And you can see that we have the alkyllithium formed on an sp2 carbon. So that's great. We can use sp2 centered halides to form these reagents as well. Now again, we can draw the arrow coming from our carbon lithium bond and attacking, but sometimes people represent this with the ionic form. So let's just draw it that way so we can get used to seeing it like that as well. And we'll draw our arrow from this negative charge attacking at the carbon. We'll form the alkoxide, which we can now treat with acid, maybe one equivalent of HCl, and form our alcohol. Notice that reacting the aldehyde gave us secondary alcohol here. And these are super important reactions because we're forming a carbon-carbon bond. If you're a synthetic organic chemist trying to make drugs or more complex molecules, forming carbon-carbon bonds is key in synthesis. Okay, we have another reaction that forms a carbon-carbon bond. That's epoxide opening. For this example, let's use the phenyl reagent again, but we're going to use a Grignard this time. And we're going to react this with a substituted epoxide. When we add the epoxide to this reagent, the nucleophilic carbon atom is going to attack on the side with least steric hindrance. You see, we have the little methyl over here. So the bond is going to form on this side, the least sterically hindered side. Now remember, we have two hydrogen atoms hanging off of here. So we have four bonds to this carbon. We're going to need to break a bond. Well, with these strained ring epoxides, they can open pretty readily, pushing these electrons up onto oxygen. That gives this intermediate. Now, when you're attacking epoxides, you might want to number your carbon atoms just to keep track of everything. Now, if we number on here, this carbon where we formed the bond is carbon 1. We can add in the rest of our numbers. And we can clearly see we have everything drawn correctly because the oxygen is going to remain on carbon 2. That's the bond that didn't break. And the bond between the oxygen and carbon 1 is broken. When we treat this with acid, we again get an alcohol. I just want to draw a dotted line where we formed our bond right here. So we'll notice that our alcohol and the carbon that it's on is one carbon away from where we formed the new bond. Whereas in these mechanisms, the alcohol is attached where we add this group. And as a reminder, attack occurs at the least hindered side of the epoxide. The next reaction we'll discuss is deprotonation. This is the compound N-butyl lithium. And we're going to show what happens when N-butyl lithium is in the presence of an acidic proton. For example, the OH group of ethanol. Well, Grignard reagents are carbon-centered nucleophiles. These are some of the strongest bases that we've met yet in organic chemistry. So we're going to get an acid-base reaction with the Grignard acting as the base. This will form two products, butane, which is a gas and bubbles out of your solution, plus an alkoxide. Now, there are cases where we use Grignard reagents to deprotonate something and use that as a nucleophile. But with something like an alcohol, we could deprotonate this with sodium hydride. Usually, these are groups that we want to watch out for in our molecule to make sure the Grignard is actually making a carbon-carbon bond and not just deprotonating something. Some of the groups that Grignards will deprotonate are alcohols, as we just discussed, amine groups, carboxylic acids, amides containing an acidic proton on the nitrogen, and then one that you might not expect as much, terminal alkynes. This proton here has a pKa of about 25. The conjugate acid of our Grignard, butane, has a pKa around, almost 40. And so the Grignard reagent is sufficiently basic enough to take off this proton here. Let's end on a quick synthesis example that'll show us how to avoid deprotonation when we're trying to form a carbon-carbon bond. So we're starting with this ketone here. We want to form an alcohol, and we have an extra ethyl group here. We can add ethyl lithium or ethyl magnesium bromide to this carbonyl, but we have an acidic group in the molecule as well. Now, in all honesty, with this example, we could probably treat this with an excess of ethyl lithium, deprotonate here, and add here. But let's just say ethyl lithium is just representing maybe a Grignard reagent that we made in a six-step synthesis. It's very precious to us. We don't want to waste one bit of it. So how would we approach this problem then if we don't want to waste one equivalent of our Grignard deprotonating here? What we can do is use a protecting group that will remove the acidic proton here. Then we can react this group and then remove the protecting group off of the alcohol. An example of a protecting group that's useful in this particular situation is the benzyl group. We can first add in sodium hydride, which will deprotonate the alcohol, producing the phenoxide, an alkoxide on a phenyl ring. Then that will attack benzyl bromide in an SN2 reaction, and we'll get this compound. So benzyl is this CH2 phenyl, so this piece right here is our protecting group. This no longer contains an acidic proton, so now we can treat the compound with ethyl lithium, and then acid in a second step to protonate the alkoxide, which will give us this compound. The benzyl group can be removed by hydrogenation. And you might be thinking, KP, there's a lot of double bonds in here. Well, aromatic rings are not as susceptible to hydrogenation, so we can typically do hydrogenolysis to remove this benzyl group without affecting the aromatic ring. We'll treat this with hydrogen and palladium on carbon, and arrive at our desired final product. In this lesson, we learned how to turn carbon from an electrophile into a nucleophile via an alkyllithium and Grignard reagent. We learned two reactions to form carbon-carbon bonds, the addition to the carbonyl and epoxide opening. We also learned that Grignard reagents can deprotonate things quite well. They are strong bases. And we learned some groups to watch out for if you're not trying to deprotonate things and actually trying to form a carbon-carbon bond. And finally, we looked at an example of a synthesis that used a protecting group to avoid deprotonation. I hope you learned something. If you did, please click that notification bell so we can do more chemistry together.